Hi, good evening. This is Saturday night at 5 o'clock. We will be celebrating the fourth Sunday of Lent in a few moments. But just to make an announcement, every Saturday night we will be doing this live stream Mass at 5 p.m. Immediately after, or 5 minutes after, probably close to 5:40, 5:45, we'll be doing the Mass also in Spanish. During the weekdays, we will do Mass at 12 noon, Monday to Friday. 12 noon Mass, Monday to Friday in English. We hope that you can pray with us, and even though you cannot receive the Eucharist, to spiritually, in your heart, ask that the Lord come into you, to be with you, and we celebrate the Eucharist here. Thank you, God bless you. A reading from the book of Samuel. The Lord said to Samuel, "Fill your horn with oil and be on your way. I am sending you to Jesse of Bethlehem, for I have chosen my king from among his sons." As Jesse and his sons came to the sacrifice, Samuel looked at Eliab and thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed is here before him." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not judge from his appearance or from his lofty stature, because I have rejected him. Not as man sees, does God see. Because man sees the appearance, but the Lord looks into the heart." In the same way, Jesse presented 7 sons before Samuel. But Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen any one of these." Then Samuel asked Jesse, "Are these all the sons you have?" Jesus replied, "There is still the youngest who is tending the sheep." Samuel said to Jesse, "Send him. We will not begin the sacrificial banquet until he arrives here." Jesse sent and had the young man brought to him. He was ruddy, a youth handsome to behold, and making a splendid appearance. The Lord said, "There, anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel, with the horn of oil in his hand, anointed David in the presence of his brothers. And from that day on, the Spirit of the Lord rushed upon David. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our response to the psalm: "The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. In verdant pastures he gives me repose. Besides restful waters he leads me, he refreshes my soul.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
He guides me right past for his name's sake. Even though I walk in the dark valley, I fear no evil. For you are at my side with your rod and your staff that give me courage.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
You spread a table before me in the sight of my foes. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows.
The Lord is my shepherd. There is nothing I shall lack.
Only goodness and kindness follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord for years to come.
The Lord is my shepherd.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. Brothers and sisters, you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of light, for light produces every kind of goodness and righteousness and truth. Try to learn what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the fruitless works of darkness. Rather, expose them, for it is shameful even to mention the things done by them in secret. But everything exposed by light becomes visible. For everything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will give you light. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Glory and praise to you, O Lord Jesus Christ. Glory and praise to you, O Lord Jesus Christ.
The Lord be with you.
With your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you.
Now, if we were in church, I would ask you now to sit down, but I'm sure you're home, so you're seated already. Last week, this week, and next week, there are three very long Gospels. There's stories in John, and each story is a very well-developed and a beautiful story of growing in faith. So what I'm going to do is to read pieces or sections of the Gospel at a time and comment on them to get the picture of how faith grows in a man born blind, and it grows because of opposition. As Jesus passed by, he saw a man lying from birth. His disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, neither he nor his parents sinned. It is so that the works of God might be made visible through him. We have to do the works of the one who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world. When he had said this, he spat on the ground, made clay with the saliva, and smeared the clay on his eyes, and said to him, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which means sent. So he went and washed and came back, able to see. We have at the beginning of these stories something that gets the attention of people. If you remember the gospel from last week, it was the Samaritan woman at the well, where what got everybody's attention was, first of all, that Jesus was in Samaria, and Jews and Samaritans didn't get along. That he was talking to a woman he didn't know, which was certainly against the social mores, and that the woman was a Samaritan, and that she was at the well at noontime, which was the time when women avoided going to town, because men and women didn't mix. They were gone to the well early in the morning. So, last week, Jesus got the attention of this woman by the way he acted. Today he gets the attention by doing something else. He takes a man who's born blind and makes him see. There are things that get our attention too. Things that challenge us to think about, maybe there's more here. Maybe there's something dealing with God or Jesus or whatever it might be. Something beyond just what's happened now. And we think about those things. What could it be in your life and mine that every now and again gets our attention? Could it be a change in someone's life we know? Could it be that someone who got sick got better? Could it be something that's going on in the world, even something like the coronavirus, that makes you stop and think, is there something deeper here than just what's happening? His neighbors and those who had seen him earlier as a beggar said, isn't this the one who used to sit and beg? Some said it is, but others said, no, he just looks like him. He said, I am. So they said to him, how were your eyes opened? He replied, the man called Jesus made clay and anointed my eyes and told me, go to Siloam and wash. So I went there and washed and was able to see. And they said to him, "Where is he?" He said, "I don't know." At this stage, all that's happening is that you're trying to make sure that what said happened really happened, that the man born blind, the man who could not see, now could really see. And so this question about it and asking is this really the one who got healed? And we go through that too with these things that happen around us, things going on in our world. We ask, did it really happen? And if it happened, what does it mean? Is there something deeper here that you and I have to pay attention to? They brought the one who was once blind to the Pharisees. Now Jesus had made clay and opened his eyes on the Sabbath. So then the Pharisees also asked him how he was able to see. He said to them, "He put clay on my eyes and I washed and now I can see." So some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, because he does not keep the Sabbath." But others said, "How can a sinful man do such signs?" And there was a division among them. So they said to the blind man again, "What do you have to say about it, since he opened your eyes?" He said, "He is a prophet." Now comes the first opposition to seeing anything deeper, to seeing anything of faith in what has happened. Here the blind man has been made to see, but the religious leaders who are opposed to Jesus say, "Well, it couldn't have been happened, couldn't happen, as you said, because this man didn't serve our work. He didn't work on the Sabbath, which we're not allowed to do. So therefore, this is not true. This did not really happen." So they asked the blind man, "What do you have to say about him, since he opened your eyes?" The blind man is not put off by their hostility. He says very simply, "He's a prophet. I believe he is someone who is sent from God." So the opposition pushes the blind man to refer even more strongly to his faith in what happened to him and in the one who did it. And so it can be for us that we see faith in something, we see call of Jesus in something, we see God touching our life in something, whatever that's gotten our attention. And we bring it up and our world is not very sympathetic to seeing God and seeing Jesus or believing in what he does. And maybe even our friends around us say, "What do you make of all this? It can't be that this is really God or this is really Jesus touching the life of mine." And the first response should be like this man in the story. "Oh, I believe. I believe Jesus touched my life in some way. I believe he's a prophet, that is, he speaks for God in my way in what happened here." Now the Jews did not believe that he had been blind and gained his sight until they summoned the parents of the one who had gained his sight. They asked him, "Is this your son who you say was born blind? How does he now see?" His parents answered and said, "We know that this is our son and that he was born blind. We do not know how he sees now, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him, he's of age, he can speak for himself." His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that if anyone acknowledged him as the Christ, he would be expelled from the synagogue. For this reason, his parents said, "He is of age, question him." Now, other people are brought into this discussion, trying to verify, did this happen, and what's the reason for it happening, and how did it happen? And the persons they bring in, that the religious leaders bring in, are the parents. And we heard the questioning, "Is this your son? Can he see? Was he blind?" He said, "Yes, our son, he could see. He was blind, and now he can't see." And he asked, "Well, how do you explain it?" And he said, "Oh no, leave us out of this. This is not our issue. He's of age, question him." That happens in our life too, that other people are asked to look at what's going on and to ask the question, could Jesus really be working here? But so many times people are unwilling to take that kind of stance, that people are unwilling to express anything about their own faith. And you know, it's interesting that it's the parents of a man who are asked about their son, did this really happen? What do you make of it? Because it's so much an issue in our day of parents who are asked or called upon to talk to their children about God, to answer their questions about God. And so many are unwilling. Maybe they feel unprepared, maybe they feel They just don't have answers. But parents should not be afraid to talk about God from their own heart, their own faith, to talk with their children, to lead them, to guide them, not to back off and say, he or she will have to make up a mind on their own, but to say, we, as best we can, will help you to understand God. So a second time they called the man who had been blind and said to him, give God the praise. We know that this man is a sinner. He replied, if he is a sinner, I do not know. One thing I do know is that I was blind and now I see. So they said to him, what did he do to you? How did he open your eyes? He answered them, I have told you already and you did not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? They ridiculed him and said, you are that man's disciple. We are disciples of Moses. We know that God spoke to Moses, but we do not know where this one is from. The man answered and said to him, this is what is so amazing, that you do not know where he is from, yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but if one is devout and does his will, he listens to him. It is unheard of that anyone ever opened the eyes of a person born blind. If this man were not from God, he would not be able to do anything. They answered and said to him, you were totally born in sin. Are you trying to teach us? Then they threw him out. Here again is the second wave of opposition, where the blind man is questioned once again about what happened, how it happened, who Jesus is. And instead of backing off as the opposition gets stronger, his faith gets stronger. And he talks back to those who are questioning him. This is really strange. This thing happened to me and you don't know. You're saying this man is a sinner? It doesn't happen that anyone opens a blind man's eyes, but he did. So how can he not be from God? And the response, that courageous response, so angers the leaders that they throw the man out from the synagogue. And that can happen to us too, that our eyes can have been opened as the blind man's eyes were, in seeing the touch of God and something that happens in our life. And we believe that, and we work with it, and we take it into our own lives, our own hearts. And people around us say, well, we really can't associate with religious nuts anymore. We're not saying the words, but in their heart they're saying it. And so maybe we get cut off from a group we belong to, from friends we have, from relatives we have, who don't want to associate with, in quotes, religious fanatics. But we need the courage in those situations, even when our faith would put us forth from other people, to say, I believe. When Jesus heard that they had thrown him out, he found and said, do you believe in the Son of Man? He answered and said, who is he, sir, that I may believe in him? Jesus said to him, you have seen him, and the one speaking with you is he. He said, I do believe, Lord, and he worshipped him. There's the end of the story, that because the man, the blind man, has kept his faith in the midst of opposition, now he sees more fully who Jesus is, what he means in his life. And so it is for us. As we struggle with the things we try to believe in, as we struggle with our faith, as we struggle with trying to see God working in our world, to keep believing that the Lord is there, and that finally comes that great moment when we can say, I do believe, Lord. So, how does our faith grow in the gospel today? It grows through opposition. Through opposition that makes us look at what we believe and how we believe it, and to keep reaffirming when we're sure of our faith that Jesus is with us so that we can say, I do believe, Lord. Times of thanks. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, life everlasting. Amen. And now, trusting in God's goodness and his care for us, bring before him our needs.
Our response will be, Lord, hear us. For the Church, may God help us remain faithful to all of his commandments and grow in the fullness and the light of the truth, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For elected officials, may the Lord grant them the fortitude to remain true to his justice, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who suffer in mind, body, and spirit, especially those who are blind physically, spiritually, or intellectually, may the healing power of Christ come upon them, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those who are praying with us, those at home, Bishop Sala, myself, that the Lord God may increase in us the spirit of conversion, hope, and openness, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those affected by the coronavirus here in our country and throughout the world, in a particular way for the nurses and medical staff and those in hospitals and other places that care for them, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intention of this Eucharist, which is for Kathleen Schneider, Frederick J. Seifert, Sr., and Harry Mumler, for them and for all who have died, may they share the fullness of peace with Christ, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, hear us as we present these and all our needs before you, through the loving hands of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and rock. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God forever.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
And Lord, accept the sacrifice at your hands, and praise the Lord's name, for our good and for all the Church.
We place before you with joy these offerings, which bring eternal remedy, Lord, praying that we may both faithfully revere them and present them to you as is fitting for the salvation of all the world, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. By the mystery of the Incarnation, he has led the human race and walked slavery to ancient sin through the waters of generation to make them your adopted children. Therefore, all creatures of heaven and earth sing a new song in adoration. We, with all the host of angels, cry out without end acclaim,
Holy, 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 holy Lord God, God of hosts,
heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest. You, therefore, Almighty Father, we bless with Jesus Christ, your Son, who comes in your name. He himself is the word that brings salvation, the hand you extend to sinners, the way by which your peace is offered to us. When we ourselves have turned away from you on account of our sins, you brought us back to be reconciled, Lord, so that, converted at last to you, we might love one another through your Son, whom for our sake you handed over to death. And now, celebrating the reconciliation Christ has brought us, we entreat you, sanctify these offerings by the outpouring of your Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, whose command we fulfill when we celebrate these mysteries. When about to give us life, to set us free, as he reclined at supper, he himself took bread into his hands. Giving his thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, on that same evening, he took the chalice of blessing in his hands, confessing the mercy, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith: when we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. Celebrating, therefore, the memorial of the death and resurrection of your Son, who left us this pledge of his love, we offer you what you have bestowed on us, the sacrifice of perfect reconciliation. Holy Father, we humbly beseech you to accept us also, together with your Son, in this saving banquet. Graciously endow us with his very Spirit, who takes away everything that estranges us from one another.
May you make your church a sign of unity and an instrument of your peace among all people. May you keep us in communion with Francis our Pope and John our Bishop, with all the bishops, religious, clergy, and with your entire people. Just as you have gathered us now at the table of your Son, so also bring us together with Mary, the Blessed Virgin Mother of God, with Saint Joseph, her husband, and with all the saints, along with our brothers and sisters and those of every race and tongue who have died in your friendship. Bring us to share with them the unending banquet of unity in a new heaven and a new earth, where the fullness of your peace will shine forth in Christ Jesus, our Lord.
Through him, and with him, and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
The kingdom, power, and glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. Graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
I know that we would not be exchanging the kiss of peace here in church, but your home and your family, I'm sure you found out some way to contact each other, so please exchange the kiss of peace with one another.
Lamb of God,
you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord,
I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, my soul shall be healed.
Let us pray. O God, enlighten everyone who comes into this world. Illuminate our hearts, we pray, with the splendor of your grace, that we may always ponder what is worthy and pleasing to your majesty, and love you with all sincerity in Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us bow our heads and pray for God's blessing. Lord, look upon those who call to you and sustain the weak. Give life for your unfailing light to those who walk in the shadow of death. Bring those rescued by your mercy from every evil, reach the highest good, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Mass is ended. Let us go in the peace of Jesus Christ.
Thanks be to God. Rosie.